Shall we start the presentation, sir or madam?
Yes, sir, yes, we can.
Okay. So this is actually what we are going to, just we will see is what is ecoscaping. So what we do in ecoscaping, so what actually people are practicing in the name of tree planting. So how best they are doing, what kind of practices we need to adopt, that is what we are going to see in this presentation of ecoscaping. I come from FRLST, or it is called TDU now, Transdisciplinary University. What we actually call ecoscaping, or what we do in ecoscaping, so we study the biodiversity of the given area and blend of forest botany, ecology, environment science and landscape architecture, and we introduce ecosystem specific species. We give, in this ecoscaping, we give importance to the existing landscapes and landscape elements. And we strictly say no to invasive elements, whether they are plants, birds, fish, or any other even microorganism. And we try to maintain ecological balance in the ecoscape. And we try to provide better living ambience in harmony with nature. And also in this ecoscaping, we create aesthetically appealing, and because aesthetics is also important, and it should be ecologically functional, and of course they should be sustainable. And we have a vision to create healing gardens throughout India to achieve self-reliance in primary healthcare, at least in primary healthcare. We try to motivate people to respect our native own ecosystem by way of giving back to Mother Earth through conservation of ethnic biodiversity. And we bring interesting anecdotes on living a healthy and sustainable life in harmony with nature, appreciating plant architectures, signatures, and understanding interactions with other life forms in the ecoscape. And as I told, FRLST or Transdisciplinary University, see, we have a garden, it is called Ethno-Medicinal Garden or Amrut Healing Gardens. So here we have the largest assemblage of live medicinal plants in India. It is unique. We have more than 45 thematic layouts and 1600 species, now 1600 taxa of medicinal plants, and including insectivorous plants, which we call it as Mamsagari Gidagalu, which are very interesting to observe. And we have also several publications in our university with the many departments, and these are the publications with our ethno-medicinal garden team. And we have established or assisted in helping establishing over 0.2 million herbal gardens across India, and more than now 2000 institutional gardens across the states. And we have also received many awards, and especially this is to mention, this is in 2002 medicinal plant program designed by FRLST was selected by the United Nations. So we got our Incubator Initiative Award for the World Summit on the World Summit for the Sustainable Development and Poverty Eradication. Also some other awards. And here is my question goes. So I actually ask people, why God or Mother Nature created plants on the Mother Earth? I think already we discussed with our students and also with Rupa Madam. Is there anyone else can tell for what God or nature created plants on the Mother Earth? Anyone is there?
For the survival of other creatures.
Survival of other creatures. Okay. So,
to balance the nature.
To bring the to maintain the equilibrium on the so if we see that these are all the answers usually I used to get from people: oxygen, food, medicine, fertilizer, cloth, fodder, shelter, fuel, and again the equilibrium, right, sir, madam?
Nice.
So yes, so if you see this, and there is one more question. Yes, these are the reason. Is there any other primary reason behind this? Is there is one primary reason. I usually give the example of this. Hello, madam. Somebody asked. Hello.
Sir, oxygen.
Oxygen, I have already given here, na? Is it there or missed?
No, it's there.
It is here, see? So oxygen, because immediately people will tell oxygen is the first answer. Okay. So that it is written. So other than that, the primary reason is, so when God or the Mother Nature wanted to create this globe, which will be, it was thinking that it will be inhabitant of so many other living organisms. Okay. It thought something we need to do on the earth for them to survive. So what it does, the globe it made, it is consist of all the nutrients, but for the other living organism, but they are in the form of non-bioassimilable form. So if anybody feels iron deficiency, they cannot go to an iron ore and eat pellets of rocks, because it contains iron. So it is not possible. So God thought one intermediator should be there to convert all the non-bioassimilable form on the earth to bioassimilable form, so that the other living organisms, they can enjoy their life, they can survive first and enjoy their life. So that is how it created plants. So instead of swallowing or eating or biting on pellet of rock piece, so we eat fruits, vegetables, and other forms of other produces of plants. So this is the primary reason why God created plants on Mother Earth. So without the plants, you cannot think of anything on the earth. No other living, only plants can grow. If there is no plants, plants can grow because they have the ability to convert. So if there are no plants, no other living organisms can survive on the earth. So what it does? So it changes into in the fruit form or vegetable form, or whichever it is, it gives all the nutrients, organic nutrients, to the other living organisms. So this is the primary reason why God created. And also, God thought, or nature thought, these people are there, or animals are there, some sign of doctrine it was trying to give. So how to use plants? No. So they should know which plants to be used for what purpose, because nobody taught them. They are fresh on the earth. Mother Earth. So it was trying to give some code, some kind of signs on the shape of the plants or plant parts. That is what we call it as sign of doctrine or doctrine of signature in medicine, especially in Ayurveda. So sign of doctrine. So by seeing the shape of the plant or plant parts, animal, especially human, they started inferring the for what that can be used. If you see the Brahmi, which looks like a brain. That is how they started using for memory enhancer or as a brain tonic. Even these are the living example of sign of doctrine now. So we don't know where the sign of doctrines, which initially got created, which we might have lost now because of the human inhabitant. And if you see this plant, this looks like the joints of bones. And this we call it as Mungurvalli in Kannada, Nalleru in Telugu, I think Asti Srinkala. Right, Dr. Chaitri Gavra? Asti Srinkala, Alva?
Asti Srinkala.
Meaning? Asti Srinkala meaning?
Which resembles the bone.
Asti Srinkala, it is like a garland of some bones, something, joints of bones. Right? Are united, something. Bonishrad, Alva?
Yes.
So this is Asti Srinkala. And in Tamil, they call it as Pirandai. I think in Malayalam, it is called Chengalam Branda. And interestingly, this is one of the species which has the highest amount of calcium. And that content is given as a code in the morphology, which has so many joints like bones, so that one can know that this is the use of the plant. So few examples I have given. There are so many, even nowadays, there are so many living organisms. So that is the connection between the initial connection between the God and the plants, and then the other animals, and especially human. And after talking this, so I go into war. What is war? So war is a situation or a period of fighting. And the countries or people, they use weapons. And we will know that there is a fight going on, there is a war going on. There will be a loss, there will be a gain, whichever it is, and it is visible. But war without weapon, and that is what we call passive war or biological war. So if you see this, theoretical utilization of biological warfare from aquatic invasive species. We are not talking about even microbes like virus, bacteria, or whichever it is. We are not talking about. We are talking about the flora which we live with them every day. The problem of biological invasions. And here there is beware of lethal cousin of Onagone Soppu. So that may kill you. Plant. So and introducing invasive species is considered as a type of biological war that involves no weapon, so that we won't know what is happening, but it destroys the targeted country. And IUCN says invasive alien species are a major driver of biodiversity loss. And it is saying that it is the second most common threat associated with species that have gone completely, that is extinct. So extinction is extinction meaning there should not be even a single individual of a particular species on the mother earth. So that is what we call it as extinction. So there are so many species, they have gone extinction because of the introduction of the invasive, which we call it as alien species. And they quote, the invasive alien species lead to changes in the structure and composition of ecosystems, leading to significant detrimental impacts to ecosystem services, and ultimately, eventually, affecting economies and human well-being. That is what will be the intention of the country which is trying to make passive war on other countries. So my question is, in our country, are we not facing this? We are living happily with the plants around, with the flora around. Do we really face any threat with them? So that is what we are going to see. And in case of when we have a comprehensive planning of any ecoscape or landscape, or while introducing any species for livelihood for any community, so what kind of introduction we have done so far and what actually we should do, that we will see in few slides. So if at all say arid or semi-arid region to be ecoscape, and we need to study the rainfall, wind velocity, groundwater level as a baseline, that will help in future. After ecoscaping also, we can see or measure the difference in groundwater level, whether it is increased or not, and other edaphic conditions like soil microbiology, soil structure, soil composition, horizons, everything. And what type of plants to be selected? It should be native. They should be perennials usually, and they should be hardy, and roots should contribute to the soil conservation, soil fertility. Usually nitrogen fixing plants can be given much important, and the leaf fall can also improve the soil fertility, that kind of species that we can select. And improving lifestyle of the community, it should not just we can introduce one species that is contributing nothing to the community. So we can think of introducing plant which has fodder value, fuel, and edible plants for human consumption as fruits, vegetables, health drinks, and it can have nutritional value, medicinal value, and wood for making agriculture implements or toys, or wood can be used in constructions. This and all. And again, the added advantages can be of religious significance and political significance. So religious significance, for example, if the plant which is mentioned in any religion, they become very sacred. So people, they may not disturb the plant because of it has religious value. And the plant has political significance, like state tree of tree, which is a state tree of Karnataka, or state tree of Tamil Nadu, state tree of anything, or national tree. So that also cannot be disturbed because that will be already, it will be in the constitution, that cannot be cut. So these kind of plants that we can select. So whether do we have in our country such kind of valuable plants? We have several species. For example, few we can see. The one is Acacia nilotica subspecies indica, which I need to tell about this plant for at least 2-3 minutes, because this is the tree which has been cut or uprooted everywhere nowadays in the name of lake development, which I have observed in several lakes, which they are uprooting, and they are confusing it with other species, which is called Bellari Jali. We will come in the later part of the presentation. And this is what we call it as Kari Jali, which is indigenous to India. It is Acacia nilotica subspecies indica. It has several health problems, and it is used in several health problems, and including in promotion of dental health, which is we use it as a bubble, toothpaste. We may remember it. And it also controls hair fall, and it heals wounds, and it produces beautiful gum, and which is also edible, and it is also used as adhesive commercially, and it produces fruit which is released by the cattle, which is very tasty for them. And in addition, it attracts and it gives home for several birds. And this is one species. And then we have Acacia catechu, which we call it as Kadira or Kagli. In Kannada, there are two names. I think Kadira is mostly of scientific, the Sanskrit or Hindi origin. And Kagali is the typical Kannada name. And this is the plant, the wood powder is used in the health drink. And this health drink, which is the wood which is boiled in the water, is supposed to enhance the metabolism of the body, which is extensively used in Kerala state. And also we might have observed in when we eat beeda, so they apply this katta, and this is made out of the wood powder of this plant. This is also native to India, and it looks so, though it is a thorny plant, it looks so beautiful with flowers. And other one, as I told, it has both religious and political significance, which is called Bandimara in Kannada, Prosopis cineraria. So this is a state tree for, I think, Rajasthan, and it is very religious, considered very religious in Hindu religion. And it is, they tell Pandavas, they were hiding storing their weapon, arms on this tree. And Dasara, it was given so much respect during Dasara. This is Bandimara. And another mara is Kedadari, which is again so beautiful. And this is a tree deciduous element. The flower bud, beautiful inflorescence with the budding stage, beautiful. And fresh flowers, very beautiful as a twig. And the individual flower, again beautiful. After pollination, after the tiredness even. So this is so beautiful oil, which is going to wither. And this is also highly medicinal. You can see it is native to and the Indian subcontinent. This is again native, and it is used in several health problems, especially in Siddha medicine. So they call it as Vidathalai, and we call Edathari. So we have so many such species, but ultimately what introduction we got was, this is the Bellary Jali. So Bellary Jali, where it comes from? It comes from, it is actually American some plant, and it is invasive in so many countries. Okay. And this is a plant we brought to India as a savior for the arid region or drought regions. It is called Bellary Jali in Karnataka, because it is known, it is everywhere. If you cross Tumkur and this is Bangalore, and you will see only through, anyway, it is through Andhra Pradesh, or it is Bellary, Karnataka district, and you will see everywhere this jali only. And they introduced this as a savior for and livelihood for the community there. But it is, even industrial factories and vehicles, because of this high amounts of heavy metals used in industrials accumulated in Prosopis leaves and pods, it is recommended to keep livestock away from grazing. And they introduced, the one of the major reasons for introducing this, they were telling it as it will be for cattle, for the livestock. But the research tells it is storing heavy metals so that we should keep away the livestock. Even the forest in Bhavanisagar range, was a recovery forest and lost habitat is slowly rejuvenating. It forms part of the Nilgiri biosphere, whichever it is. And here also subsurface jury flora is mentioned as a invasion. So it is even growing, they are eliminating the species in higher altitude. So this is the introduction we have given. So leaving all the such kind of species, which I told earlier, so we have got one plant from somewhere in North America. This is what we should not do. And this is what actually we are doing. And after the introduction of this Prosopis juli flora, it has eaten away all our native species. You see, it has already swallowed, almost it has swallowed the dicrostachys in area, and it has already taken in one hand Prosopis bisera bundle, and it is again it is Acacia planifrance. This is another native plant. It is facing problem. And this, that is what I told, Karijali, Acacia nilotica subspecies India, it has trampled it. And without the difference between Karijali and Bellarijali, and when we discussed with the inhabitants, local people in the lake near villages, lake surrounding villages, they themselves, usually we tell villages are knowledgeable. So we actually learn from them. So wherever I go or wherever we go, we first learn from villages, because they are the knowledge of our storehouse of knowledge which we consider. But here in the semi-urban areas, in the villages, so recently inhabitant people from somewhere from other states, so they are considered as a village people, and they give some nonsense names to them without knowing what is actually going on. So that is how this Acacia nilotica subspecies indica or Karijali, which is very, very important species in the ecoscape or ecosystem, is being uprooted. And Acacia catechu, again, it is at the verge of death on the earth. So this is the overall impact of Prosopis juli flora, which is introduced by the government of India itself. And do we have anything, okay, that's happened in the nature, do we have any responsibility? Do the country has any responsibility? What should the country do? Is there any guidelines? If you see, if you ask, the Constitution of India itself tells us, a state policy, that means the country's policy, the state or the country shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. I think very few countries in the world, they have incorporated such agenda in the constitution itself, and this is known as India. Okay, that is, it is okay, country which does government department that will do something, and as an individual, what should we do? Is there any responsibility for us? So if anyone asks, the next one comes as a citizen of India, what you should do. That is fundamental duties. Fundamental duties of citizen. And Constitution says in the 51A G, to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife, and to have a compassion for living creatures. So you cannot tell, I don't know which is happening. I don't know. That is wrong. I don't know. The ignorance of the Constitution and the fundamental duty itself, it is a punishable thing, offense. So as per the Constitution of India, as per the fundamental duties of a citizen, it is very well written, we need to protect and improve the natural environment. And they have clearly told, there should not be any confusion. So they have mentioned all ecosystems like forest, lakes, river, and entire wildlife. And also we should have, not just going, just we have the compact, we should have the compassion for other living creatures, which is completely absent in, I think, 95% of the citizens in India, which I feel. And So what is happening to the landscapes or the different ecosystems in India, which is very very political, which what is happening to during maybe 30, 35 years or what, almost 40 years of my observation, what is happening is, you know, let us see in different landscapes what is happening. So this is how our farmlands were very pure. So in my childhood, I don't think we had only few, very few kinds of weeds on our farmlands, which is like cypress rotundus, which we call Tungi Gadde in Kannada and Mushta in Ayurveda, which is actually a precious Ayurveda medicinal plant. And after uprooting that weed, that was sold in the market. It was a weed only for the particular that cultivation, because it is invaded. Otherwise, it is a precious medicinal plant. That is what we were weeding out and we were selling to the store. But now, if you go to any farmland, you will find minimum of 100 species of invasiveness, which are all introduced alien species. And one important is, you may be knowing this, Parthenium hysteroporus scientifically. We call very fondly in Karnataka, Congress Gida. So this Congress Gida, you can see anywhere, everywhere, not everywhere, you see the farmland. So there are farmers, they left cultivation because they could not combat, they could not, what is it, they because of the struggle, they left it. So we can't do anything. So let me sell the land for a real estate or whichever it is. So I feel 50% of the farmers who left cultivation is mainly for such kind of invasive species, especially this Congress. Congress means Congress Gida. And it is also, in addition, which gives very harmful effects on human. It causes skin allergy, fever, then asthmatic problems. So many bronchial. There are so many, and for human and also for livestock. And we are trying to remove now after so many years, after seeing this. And now we are thinking that that can be eliminated. It is, I think, almost we are, I think we are going to suffer for long. So that is how I always tell, whenever we see one invasive species, we try to eliminate immediately. If we allow them for few years, then they will take away the whole ecosystem of our native nature. And when we come to the aquatic ecosystem, which were very pure, and it was considered as almost a divine. And the ecosystem and the plants, the flora, the major flora in the aquatic ecosystem, one is lotus in the two color variants. One is yellow, the one is pink, and another one is white, which is it was given a divinity as goddess Lakshmi and goddess Saraswati. So this is how our aquatic ecosystem was there. And what happened to this is, this photograph is not from anywhere else. It is our Ramagundahalli here in Yelahanka. You see the lake, and they are trying, every time they are trying to clean. I have seen 3-4 times they have done it. I have seen. But they are unable to control this Hypomia carnia subspecies Fistulosa. And if they leave even one stick of 2-3 inches long, that is enough. And within a year, they spread everywhere in the lake. This was recently cleared lake. Now you see at least 30% of the area is already occupied by this plant. And this has, the problem with this plant is, this has hollow stem, and also the leaves, the stomata, number of stomatas, they will transpirate the water. That means empty the water from the lake very quickly. Maybe we can tell it more than around 10,000 times of what other plants, our native plants, they do. And this is, again, there are so many health problems it causes. And the smoke which was burnt, if anybody inhales, they get jaundice. And the goat which eats this leaf, even unknowingly, with other grasses, it gets paralyzed. And it is, this has also displaced a community, this inland fisher community. It was very prominent earlier. So now that community itself not there because they can't go in inside the lake because of the invasiveness of this plant. They can't go inside the lake itself. It entangles. And other ecosystem is, the primary ecosystem is forest. And the forests were so pure. And you can read in any literature of your own language. And when they describe the forest, and you can really imagine how pure it was, how pristine it was. So now what is happening here, there are hundreds of invasive species they introduced even into the forest. And the forest floor is so important, the grasslands are so important, because all the herbivores, they depend only on this. They do not go to the canopy. They live on the forest floor. But what they did, they introduced one plant called lantana, which is very sturdy. Again, not only hardy, which is very sturdy. And the stem is like, it is woody, we call it. A kind of woody species. Just completely gone invasive, and throughout India, not only here, throughout India, and it has occupied the forest floor, which is the food for, or the living habitat for the herbivores. So they do not get any food, they do not get any forage. So they, what they do, in the absence of the ground cover, they come out of the forest and they go into the habitations in search of food. They are not, they, no animal has intention to kill the human. No animal has intention. If they have intention, no man can live on the earth. So they come in search of food. And there the animal, human-animal conflict starts. And also some pathetic situations we see. So this is the ultimate contribution of human to the wildlife, which is strictly told as a caring these animals and wildlife as a fundamental duty in the constitution of India. And how we are doing the duty, just you can see in the two visuals. And so as I told earlier, the human-animal conflict, this mother and cub, they came into the habitation. There was a conflict again with the human. So they killed it. It is so sad. However, I read it like that only, as such. However, they decided to fight back by separating the mother and her cub so they could kill them easily. This forced some villagers to shoot the animal with 12 bore shotguns. Meanwhile, a second group villagers followed the cub and forced it to enter the restroom of a seminary in Dabar Katha village. They killed the cub with a 12-bore shotgun. Wildlife officials told to the Express Tribune the female bear was 27 years old, while her cub was only one. And in addition, you see earlier this week, villagers killed a bear with her two minor cubs at a forest in Palakot. This is the fundamental duties we serve. And this, the main reason is not intention of the human. It is the ignorance and the flora which is around us. What we are seeing, what is happening, and no one cares. And even in the name of planting, what they are doing, we will see it. And these lanternas, again, they dry in during summer and they easily catch fire. And these fire lasts for weeks, 15 days, even sometimes 1 month. Because they are woody in nature. Bandipur incident we can tell, and also previous year or a couple of years back in Salem, even on trek group, 8 people were burnt alive because of the presence of lanterna. Otherwise, forest fire lasts for maybe few hours, only grasses. They catch fire and ends within parapet in 1 hour maximum, because it is just a clearing of forest floor. And interestingly, after this, and the new grasses come back very quickly because of the phosphorus, the content of phosphorus which is added. And with the lantana, it is opposite. Still some people, they support the lantana, telling that it attracts butterflies. And I should tell, it is a nonsense actually. We have thousands of species of native plants which attracts butterflies better than the lantana. And having that much of threats to all the wildlife and including human, and if you support that lantana, you know, that attracts two species of butterflies, that is absolutely nonsense. It is ignorance. That attitude should be changed as a fundamental duty of a citizen. It is not as from the request of Dr. Ganesh Babu. It is, as a citizen of India, it is a fundamental duty that you have to change your attitude. And if you see this, invasive species may soon wipe out Shola vegetation. So not only here in the plains, and in dry deciduous or evergreen, it has gone up to Shola, which are the Shola vegetation is the source for the river, source for the water. That means source for the life on the earth. So these invasive species, they are going to wipe out soon the Shola vegetation itself in Nilgiris, and it is already, we have seen it and we have reported it, and now Honorable High Court of Madras is giving guidelines to the state of Tamil Nadu to how they are going to stop this invasive species and restore and protect the Shola vegetation in Nilgiri and in Palani Hills. And so no action, such kind of action has been taken in our Karnataka state. And I want to mention this, kindly be aware that all that glitters is not gold. All that glitters is not gold. I will tell this with a few examples. And so many people may worship this plant. They feel so divine with this plant, which is called Brahma Kamala. And in Karnataka, I have seen so many, on social media, they used to invite people. So Brahma Kamala has blossomed in my home. Please come and visit and get the blessings. And what it actually is, this is called Epiphyllum accipitalum, one of the cactus species, which is native to southern Mexico and South America. And it is naturalized recently in China, China will face problem. And in India, we are gifting this plant, we are worshipping this plant, and it is again, it is invasive in nature. Somebody in Dev's garden, he has written, I have it in a container, as it has been classified as invasive. He is so careful that it should not be planted in the earth so it may escape. But even because it is a cactus and it is a succulent or semi-succulent, and if a leaf fall on the earth, that can create so many new plants and that can easily escape to the wild. And in India, we are planting in every garden and in the household. So be aware, this is not at all a Brahma Kamala. It is just a cactus which is invasive. And who has kept the name, that I don't know. And originally, the Brahma Kamala is really, it is a Brahma Kamala. It grows in high altitude Himalaya, so beautiful. Because it looks like a Kamala, the leaves or the bracts which will open into a flower, that looks like a Kamala or lotus. We call it as Brahma Kamala because which we consider the whole Himalaya as a holy. So because it grows there, it is called Brahma Kamala. And this is the close look of the plant. And they have listed so many of its uses. But no one talks about this and no one praises about this. No one feels its divinity. No one shares this in the social media. For them, it is Brahma Kamala is a cactus from South America or Mexico. So this is the ignorance. This is not intentional. Again, I am telling, this is the ignorance. So they should, before doing any kind of such kind of invitations, such kind of plantation or planting single plant, they should know what they are doing it. And even Bangalore people, they tell ours is garden city, it is so green. And if you go and observe what they call it as green and what is in their garden, most of them are nonsenses. You see Gulmohar, which is everywhere on the road. They call it as this as a flame of the forest. And this should be called as a flame of the roadside, which never comes on forest. I usually tell whoever I meet them, don't please call this as a flame of the forest. It's a flame of the roadside. And useless plant of the roadside. And it is native to Madagascar, nothing to do with India. And then this is the history which has in the invasiveness, this has created the history in India, which is Subabul, Lucayana leucocephala. It is also from tropical America. And everywhere it was introduced, and now people are struggling. I recently went to Andhra Pradesh for one school, and they asked me how to eradicate this from the school campus. They are unable to eradicate from the school campus itself. So that money, which is that kind of invasive nature, this is. And this is another Spathodia campanulata. So people will tell, wow, so beautiful. What so beautiful? It is from tropical America. This is not our, I will tell, don't think that they are all so beautiful. I will show the beauty of our native plants. We have thousands of, not hundreds, thousands of beautiful plants in our country. and don't think that these are all beauties. And this is another one, Malaysia and China and Japan, which has, I can tell confidently, 20%, 20 to 25% of the Bangalore city is engulfed by this provisionacea papyrifera, which is called paper mulberry. Everywhere you see, this is the, I think this contributes for the maybe 30% of the garden city, that green is contributed by this paper mulberry, Brousinacea papyrifera. It is, and which is crossing, literally which is crossing its city limit, and it is going towards the villages. So once it goes into the villages, and that will be the biggest problem for the farmers in the villages. It is very, very difficult to remove this. This, and there is one more species I will show. This one, Cassia senna, senna spectabilis. It is spectacular Cassia, maybe for America. For us, it is not a spectacular Cassia, troublesome Cassia. Most troublesome Cassia. Some people, they still planting it. And even without planting, because they have introduced on its own, it is growing everywhere. So if anybody comes to, anyway, I am inviting you all to visit our campus. So when we are visiting our campus and our ethno-medicinal garden, our university, so you need to cross this invasiveness. You can see literally how they are invasive on the either side of the road. Again, this is another species which is coming towards, almost it has come to the villages. Maybe another 10-15 years we will be struggling with this, unless until we are going to give much attention to this to eradicate. That is what the biological war. So we will be giving more attention, our effort, energy, money, everything on such kind of, what is that, combating this silly invasive plants. That is what they want. That is how they bring down the economy, bring down the productivity of the particular country. This is, we are facing much, much larger level. And this one, everyone will know. If you go to any farms or any campus in Bangalore or and around, or in any, maybe in South India, this silver oak will be there. And they think that it is very hardy and it will fetch money maybe after 15-20 years. So that is how they tell this, they are growing it. And they don't know, this is the one which contributes a bronchial complaints like asthma. This is the plant, the pollens of this plant. And it is again from South Wales and Queensland. And we have several species of timber value. That is what Rupa madam was asking me, sir, you give some substitute for this kind of plants. I told, we will give. Anyone, they want such kind of native plants for any substitute. So I have given a mail ID in the later part of presentation. They can contact us. So what would be the substitute for silver oak? What should be the substitute for gulmohar? What is the substitute for spathodia? We have with native plants. Not only Bangalore, in the country is this Conocarpus longifolius, which is called the Damascene. I think it is an Arabic name, Damas tree.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, one doubt, that red color palm you showed now, can you go back to that slide?
Yeah.
That's there in the hotels, no? In hotels and all resorts.
They and everywhere, all landscape, they are using this areca palm and this redneck palm.
And gulmohar also very shocking, sir. It is there in schools and all from long, 10-20 years back.
Mm-hmm. That's all. There is a politics behind that. There should be palasia, there should be butea, monosperma should be there in place of what? Dilonyx. They removed our native plant and okay. They promoted that gulmohar. because we get nothing out of that. But if you plant a mutuga, the root, root bark, stem, stem bark, leaves, flower, fruit, seed, everything is used. And most of them are, again, these parts are medicinal. So we should not get anything out of our landscape. That was their political mind. That is what we are following. We never think, okay, this landscape, how it is productive? We are seeing, okay, but how it is productive? What it is doing? What for it is there? No one asks questions. And I don't know how many of you, which you are hearing this presentation, know the constitution of India says like this. We have the fundamental duty in 5088G. And which book, which school, which college has the constitution? Nowhere we read. That is what we give the importance to the nature. That is what we give the importance to our environment and our surrounding. That is how it is all spoiled. If it is taught in the LKG onwards, and you write in the second page of the each book, the Constitution of India says for the state policy, this is, and as a citizen, this is your duty. Where it is written? It should be there. Then only the child will grow. Okay, that it will start observing. Okay, this plant, newly it has come. From where it has come, whether it is native or not. If it should be removed, it should be removed. It should be reported. Where is that attitude? It is completely missing. And this conocarpus.
Sir.
Ah, madam. Who is this?
Can I ask?
Yeah. Hello.
Sami Purni, sir.
Ah, Kelly. Sir, this,
can you hear me now, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, Dipsis leptochelios antakidar. Actually, what you have put picture is Christostachys renda, that is lipstick palm.
Okay.
This Dipsis leptochelios is another tall palm alva, sir.
Okay, I will check it. Because usually I don't go into the invasive element at all.
Okay. My doubt is, red color palm is invasive. Is whatever name it is, but the picture what you have shown is invasive.
Yeah, I understood. Maybe I have to change the botanical name of that. Maybe.
Because my old office, all landscape architects used to use this.
I accept it. So what you are telling me, this botanical name to be changed, right?
I think so, sir.
I will check it.
It's called lipstick palm and it's a favorite for landscape architects.
So this, actually, that's what I'm telling. See, these kind of palms, which are exotic and alien elements, this every day I'm seeing in the in everywhere. Which is all dumped off.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Dumped in the landscape. And they never thought of our native. No one was thinking of, we are using it, whichever it is, redneck palm or it is a lipstick palm, why we are using it? And how many of us have asked it? Oh, is there any native one is there? In place of this, why don't we put a native palm? Whether we have this, any alternate, if there is not a palm, is there any other plant which can go here, which can produce positive energy? So that is what my concern is. Thanks, madam. I will see and correct it if it is. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Sorry to interrupt you.
So this is a Terminalia mantelli. Yeah, then we were coming to this Conocarpus langifolius, which I saw first in airport at Sharjah in UAE. Yeah. And later I saw these plants. When I saw these plants in India, I got shocked how these plants came here. And nowadays, everywhere they grow it, because it grows, I think, the fastest growing species now in India, which is, we can tell this Conocarpus lancifolius. So how best and how beneficial this tree to India is, you can see that Qatar declares a Damas ban. That much beneficial plant for the landscape or ecosystem is this Conocarpus lancifolius. They have banned it. They are uprooting it. And we are extensively planting in India. And if you see this, according to local media reports in UAE, the Ministry of Municipality and Environment has asked nurseries to stop bringing the Conocarpus lancifolius trees into the country itself. But in India, this is extensively planted. That is what our, that is how we serve our fundamental duty. Or the Constitution of India itself, I can tell. How the state and the government is so ignorant of this. Because it is just a plant. And they are not knowing that just a plant is only making us to survive on the earth. And I request through this forum, anyway, people will be also hearing, maybe recorded ones in later. Unless until you know what plant and what species you are going to promote it, better not to plant. Don't do any planting. So our ecosystem will feel so happy if you don't do anything, because it has its own way to spread. It has its own way for its posterity. So don't show so much concern on with ignorance on the Mother Nature, and don't spoil them. Don't give trouble to them. The way the most of the people with the ignorance, what they are doing is the trouble to the nature. The different kinds of plantations, they call Miyawaki plantation. There is one more plantation somewhere in Shimoga. It is something, you know, Adavi.
Kas Adavi.
And without understanding the structure of the forest, the components of the forest, and they plant some trees and they call it as a forest. That itself nonsense. That itself you are failing in your fundamental duties as a citizen. That means you don't know the forest at all. Creating arboretum, creating a kind of plantation and calling it as a forest. Because forest sounds so nice, so catchy. So the people will fall for that. People will help to promote. Absolutely nonsense. And kindly do not do any planting drive unless until you know the plants which we are going to do that. But again, I am telling, if you are planting any invasive plants, you are against the Constitution of India. That you should keep in mind. It is not against me, it is not against someone who wants to promote native plants and native ecosystem. And why do we use medicinal plants, native plants? Because we should not lose our indigenous ecosystem by planting exotic. And value adds of such gardens, it is not only scenic beauty, but we can also have our own cure with these plants. And especially for chronic complaints like diabetes, dental, skin problems, and memory related issues. Now people, they understand only with the herbal, with the plants only, it is better to handle. And it brings peaceful aura, landscape experience, sensory connection it gives, and increase the biodiversity of the particular landscape. And it is also low maintenance. And as soon as we tell about native and medicinal plants, the people all ask whether it is maintenance will be large. Absolutely no. And it also gives excellent aroma. And the yellow bahinia with flavored chutney we can prepare, herbal tea and perfume. We have a perfume plant. Just pinch the plant, it oozes out resin. Just apply on your dress. It acts as a perfume. And then this is camphor tulsi. Just tightly hold the leaves and smell it. It has a strong aroma, so which will bring down the stress from your mind. And I want to show some species which can be used in the landscape or ecoscaping. So why should we use only ornamental exotic plants? So some images I can show how beautiful they are. You can just imagine. This is Kalyana Saugandhikam or Sugandhi or Saugandhika Pushpam. This Hedychium coronarium, scientifically it's native. And another native which is Beautia monosperma is one. And then this is Hedychium coccineum, which is another Saugandhikam. And this is another sulfur color, sulfur yellow they call, which has beautiful aroma. And then Sleechira oleosa, kusum tree or puvam. The tender leaves themselves, so beautiful and pretty. And this is Curcum oiled turmeric, and one Barlaria gibsoni, again endemic to Deccan. And coastal species are the most beautiful plant along the riparian or along the riverside or any water courses. And Fermiana colorata, it's again a small, a medium sized tree, which can go anywhere in the landscape and avenues and in school and college campuses. But you can't see even a single tree in anywhere in the India itself. And then Tamarix aphylla, and then Clerodendron indicum. And we also, because nowadays people, they ask, next day itself, the garden should look, our ecoscaping should look as something like forest, something like a created, immediately created ones. We also plant, we grow so larger trees, which are not, these are not translocations from uprooting one tree to another, planting in another place. But we promote nursery people and nursery society, and also we grow. So the large tree species in the containers, that means 10 year, 15 year, 20 year old trees can be just planted in the ecoscape. And also we give the user friendly, interesting signage to the ecoscape, so that it can connect people easily, the green connect. So this is one of the medium for connecting people. So it should be interesting and it should be catchy. So we give innovative signs. Certain, because it is not only what is that, preaching or teaching. So just I can, it is, somebody can ask, okay, you are telling. So it can be, anything can be advised, anything can be told. Have you done anything? Yes, we have done ecoscaping. So there are certain images which you can see, which we have created with native plants and medicinal plants. Aquatic ecosystem. This is plant, so all aromatic medicinal plants. And if anyone goes there itself, they get a kind of positive energy. If anyone wants to do yoga or meditation, something which is related to brain and mind and the heartfulness, just they can be there and they will get a complete positive energy. These plants also bring liveliness to the gardens by attracting other lives into the garden. And we also create for other institutions and the corporates. And this is one certificate which has come from our Namma Metro. So they are happy that by seeing the native plants attract so many species of butterflies, birds, and other pollinators. It is better to choose this ecoscaping for the functional and healthy ambience. This is from the Metro, which we have created a garden. This I end this today's presentation. Thank you so much for patiently hearing.
So it was a very nice class, sir. So can you give us a list of plants which we can plant and those to avoid? Silver oak has to be avoided. Gulmohar should be avoided. Tapomia, right?
I have given this garden at tdu.edu, right? Right to this. Okay, because we also want a document that how many people are changing into, okay, to native plants. How many queries are coming? So we want to know that. So kindly send a query to this garden at tdu.edu.in.
Okay, sure.
The list of species. This is one of my kind request.
So how quick they will respond?
Maybe it will take maximum of 5 days. Maximum.
Okay.
5 days, depending upon how much exhaustive use you are going. The list is. If it is only for one species substitute, that means two or three species immediately within 10-15 minutes you will get. But if you start asking for something like the whole ecoscape or something, then it will take some time.
Okay. Okay, sorry. See, nurseries and all, we see Tabomia, we see silver oak, gulmohar and all. But even they are not aware of this fact, I think.
No, because we are not going and asking them now. See, nursery people, it is their livelihood. And whatever you are using only, they will be growing. And we can't tell because they are growing, we are planting it. How many of us we have gone and asked them whether you have Fermiana colorata or whether you have Muthuga, whether you have any native plants, we know where. Iradali yen idu kodapanta ambattu. Oh, idan aak bodanta. How he will know? If you people, 10 people go and ask Muthuga, then he will tell thing. Okay, then Muthuga I can grow here, Muthuga I can keep here. So people started asking for Muthuga anta. We cannot, I never find mistake with the nursery people because it is their livelihood. It is about our architects, landscape architects, landscaping people, garden people, or anybody who drives plantation. We should go and ask them. Then only they will be okay. If you go and order 10,000 or 5,000 Muthuga, tomorrow itself you will feel, I have told no to this madam. Okay, next time anybody will come. So before that, I should have some Muthuga. Yes or no?
Yeah.
That is the demand which we have to create.
What about Dhanvantri, sir? Medicinal plants also, does it have any exceptional cases in medicinal plants?
What is that, madam? Exceptional case.
Dhanvantari means like, you know, are there any medicinal plants which have to be avoided?
Medicinal plants cannot be avoided. No, we should be avoided.
Then, okay. There's a list, no? Then we can plant all those or is...
See, that is what I'm telling. The plant which are mentioned in Ayurveda or any traditional system of medicine, okay, they are not invasive unless until recent some introduction of ethnobotanical uses, which may be somebody which they do not know the original, what is that meaning of invasive, they may give. But if you see the codified system, any reference from Siddha or Ayurveda, so they are not invasive. They should not be avoided.
Okay.
Sir, overall a good presentation. There's Ashwin here.
Ah, sir, namaskar, sir.
ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಸೊ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಶನ್ ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿತ್ತು ವೈಲ್ ನಾನು ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಸಲ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದಿಕ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ದ ನರ್ಸರಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಗೇನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಮಚ್ ಮೋರ್ and in fact I should also thank Rupa ma'am because she sent me this and a couple of things was like from the childhood now we nodidivi and what is there on the presentation has been very informative because especially we think that gulmohar is very good the looks and all of it of the flowers in summers and including the silver oak and all and yes part of this dry presentation for plantations actually so I also do a lot of it and in fact luckily got along with Rupa ma'am which actually gave us more insights on silver oak and all yeah so thank you so much for sharing this knowledge and
so, we will stay connected. you are going to drive now onwards native plants
absolutely sir in fact new head kunche already sent an email to that email address while us on the Zoom call
great thank you so much sir.
yeah thank you so much for this and look forward for any support from our side
sir. yes sir we are also ready to give any assistance
sure
okay Rupa madam
sir the recording you please send me sir
ha I will send Is there any question from our student who were there? Okay then. Okay, Rupa madam, then shall we finish this session?
Yes sir. Yeah, I think.
Thank you so much for your passion towards this. So from starting onwards, so I was observing you. So I was feeling so happy, so that you are becoming a kind of barrier for the jawan of delivering the duties for the country by promoting native plants. Thank you so much, and for organizing this also.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Very nice session, very informative and very engrossing, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. It was a nice session. We came to know so many things.
Welcome, madam.
We were unaware.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.